Hello, friends. Heidi here from Rain Country. God is good all the time. And I'm here today to talk about some sewing projects. I do have several videos that I'm going to be linking you back to show how to do some of the various things I'm going to be talking about today. But the first one I want to talk about, I do not have a video out on yet, but I'm hoping it will at least give you an idea on how to do that. And that is making a rag style quilt. Now, I originally was going to shoot this video, but it just got too busy and I didn't have time to worry about trying to shoot the video while I was making this quilt. Now, if you've never heard of a rag style quilt or seen one before, this is what they look like. This would be considered the top of the quilt right here, and you can see the seams are on the outside. This is the same design I use for making my denim purses and also my denim rag style quilts. So I'll show you what the back side of this one looks like. The cool thing about a rag style quilt is that they immediately are double-sided, and depending on how you want it to look, so you can have the nice smooth side be out or you can have the rag style be out. It just depends on how you decide to do the back. Now, some people choose to just use a solid color fabric on the back of theirs. But what I did different with this baby quilt was I actually repeated the same exact design on the other side, but then the difference is you can either have the rag style or have it look the same, but just have a classic quilt looking style from the opposite side. So the pieces actually line up. So you see the gray with the trees right here. If I flip that over, it's the same one here. See how that works? That actually made it a lot easier for laying out, so I didn't have to worry about making sure that when I went to lay out the pieces, like I did here where I decided to have the back kind of be more of a checkerboard type style, I needed to make sure as I laid out my rows, I went red, gray, and so on. So that I ended up with the appropriate pattern. Or like one quilt I did for my son, where I did the whole back in just a plaid, and it was all the same material, which wasn't such a big deal, but one thing I didn't pay attention to was the direction I cut it, each one of the rectangles, so that some of the plaids ended up kind of going the wrong way, and I didn't realize it till I got it all together, but that was the back side of the quilt anyway, so it wasn't that big a deal. But anyway, it is nice if you can make it where it can look good either way. And that's what I was going here with this. Now, when you put the quilt together, after you have it together, what you decide to do with the edges is going to be up to you. You can simply snip them like I did here. Because what you do after you have it all together, you got to snip every single edge. So that's time consuming. It's faster than hand quilting it, but it is still time consuming. And then you wash it up, and that's where you get this look right here. But if you wanted to, because like in this case it's double-sided, and I might still do this, I haven't quite decided yet, but you can go ahead and put a border along that. So you can have a real traditional looking style quilt on one side, and then you would have this rag quilt with a nice finished edge when you flip it over. So it's definitely a matter of choice. So how you do this, it is pretty simple. I would say it was probably one of the simplest quilts to make, because really as you're putting it together, you're quilting it already. So there's no need to do any quilting after it's all done, as I said earlier. So what you're doing is you're laying the three pieces of fabric out. Now when I do my denim quilts, I don't line them with anything. I don't put any kind of batting or anything inside them. But because this was just some plain cotton, and I did want it a little bit thicker, I definitely did use some batting. So I got some 100% cotton batting for the inside of it, because I really didn't want to use the polyester on this, especially with the edges coming out. And I'll go ahead and link below to the batting that I got. It seems like now every time I link to something, it's always gone. So I never know what to expect, but I'll see if I can find it and link to it below. But anyway, I cut the batting, and then each of the pieces all the same size. And then I laid them out so it's a triple layer. So I've got the bottom, the batting, and the top. And I laid them out in the order that I wanted them to go. And as you can see in some of the pictures that I'm putting here, I used to always use like post-it notes and then try to recycle them that I numbered. I finally got smart and took some scrap fabric and then just numbered it like that so that I could actually pin it. I don't have to worry about it ripping. And then I would number my rows like so. And that way, when I go to put them together, there's no confusion when I have them stacked. So I know which row goes where, because I spend a lot of time trying to lay them out and get the look that I want. So if you look at this, you'll see that I have like, if you go at a diagonal, I've got fox prints here. If you go at a diagonal here, you can see the three different gray fabrics I used. And then here would be the greens. I had actually three different greens that I used. And then I had some kind of brownish colors that I used. And so I set that up because I don't want any of the fabrics touching each other, you know, any of the same. And so for me to work it that way, that makes it the easiest, and it keeps everything spread out. All the different fox prints are somewhat spread out. The different greens are somewhat spread out. But I lay it out lengthwise, row like this. And then when I stitch them together, I'll stitch that long strip of row together first. Then I will stitch the number two row together, you know, at the short ends, right? And then once I have that together, then I put the rows together, as you can see in this picture, which would be actually back to back. So, and then stitch it down. Now here's the tricky part, especially when you're stitching the two rows together. What I found a little more frustrating when dealing with these fabrics and with the batting on the inside than just doing the denim, even though the denim is heavier, because I didn't have a batting on the inside, I didn't have as many different pieces to work with. And so with that batting, you're gonna find you gotta be very careful. The nice thing about the cotton batting is I didn't actually pin the fabrics together, but you may wanna consider doing that anyway. I didn't wanna go through that hassle because I hate working with pins. But what I found was that as I would be stitching the rows together, so I'm laying them like this, stitching them this way, and then I would go look at the other side, and I would find that this fabric here on this side had slipped out of the stitching, and then I had to take it apart and then restitch it together, because it just, because of the so many layers, it just, those inside fabrics, the ones on this side, tend to want to slip out. But then the same thing can happen, like I found some areas on this side where, say, I was stitching it this way and these pieces here didn't come out, I didn't get them nice and flat like I should have, and then the fabric would kind of slip out this way or just end up a little bit too short, making me have to go back and restitch over it to make sure that that's not going to come out with washings. So this was new for me to do it this way, though I've made several. I just didn't have those problems when I was doing it with just the two, which actually when you're sewing it together is only four layers. When you're doing it with the batting on the inside, it's actually six layers you're sewing together at the same time. That's where it gets a little bit frustrating when you're working with that. But it is a fun style of quilt to make, and I do like the fact that I don't have to go back and quilt it. So if you're new to quilting and don't know anything about it, typically what you're going to do is, let's just say this is a normal quilt, I would put my whole, this would be the quilt top, I'd put all this together first, it'd just be the single layers, so you'd lay that down, put your batting over that as one big piece, put your backing over that as one big piece, and start pinning it from the inside out and work out that way. And when you quilt it, you want to do the same thing. You don't want to work from the outside in or from the top to the bottom. You want to work from the inside and out when you're quilting. But anyway, so in some ways this is easier, but in some ways it's a little more frustrating. It has different challenges than when you're working with the other one. But it is just a fun, different way that you can do a quilt. So if you're already into quilting, that might just be an idea. If you're new to sewing, I don't know if this just talking you through that much of it is going to help you. But hopefully those pictures I showed will give you some ideas of how you can put it together. It, you know, like I said, it's fairly simple. You just got to watch for the slippage of the fabric and make sure you're getting all those pieces in there. And you may even want to consider cutting your squares, your rectangle, whatever shape you decide to do, a little bit bigger. Give yourself more seam allowance in that than than I did here in order to make up the difference if there's any slippage. Let me talk about a couple other projects that I do have videos on that I recommend you consider, and these are simple things. One of those is making your own napkins, your cloth napkins. I've made these years ago. We've been using cloth napkins for a long time. It was one of those things that's like, why hadn't I thought of doing this sooner? Why am I going through paper napkins when cloth napkins are easy to make and easy to wash up? And so, you know, obviously we're talking table napkins here. And so basically you just got a long rectangle, you fold it over and you stitch it. I have a video on this that I will link to in the description box. Again, don't forget to click on show more if you're on a computer, and if you're on a smart device, then what you might be wanting to look for is a little gray arrow just to the right and underneath the video itself, as you can see in the pictures I put right there. If you open up that description box, you'll find the video on how to make your own table napkins. Now, one thing that's new to mine is that what I have here is I just used some extra fabrics that I had on hand of just plain cotton, like this one and this one here. This one was a flannel. The flannel ones are definitely thicker, but they are really nice. I mean, it's soft. It actually cleans a little bit better as far as, you know, when you're wiping your hands or your face or whatever. And then these ones here are a new addition that I made from some extra linen I had left over from a linen skirt that I made for a lady. You can make your own cloth napkins and then save yourself money with not having to purchase the disposable napkins. Even if you have to go buy some of this fabric because maybe you don't have scraps that you can use, in the long run, you'll be saving yourself money because you'll be able to use them again and again and again for years and years to come. Just like any other cloth items that I've talked about. I do also, it's a little more complicated, but I do have a video on how you can make your own cloth feminine napkins. And I tell you, when I made that change in my younger years, when I was still having a cycle, it was the best thing I ever did. I wish I had done it much sooner, right? Right from the start, I knew it was the right thing. You cramp less, your flow gets over with quicker, you just feel better in general. And I think it's also a safer alternative to the Diva Cup that a lot of people talk about. That's my personal opinion. I just don't think that is as natural or as safe, but if that's what works best for you, that might be a consideration. Just kind of look into it. There's something about silicone being for long periods of time in such a sensitive area that's not meant to be blocked off that way. So just, you know, just think about it. Believe it or not, cloth is so much easier to deal with than you probably think it is, and it's so much more comfortable. Way more comfortable and much quieter too. And then a couple other projects. I don't actually have a video on this, but this one is easy. I like to make the dog his own scarves. I don't buy them because they're so easy to make, but also because the ones you buy are usually a perfectly straight triangle. Well, if you look at the way I've got this shaped, okay, it's very elongated this way to give you more to tie with. And then I need to hem this. I'm just showing you what it looks like when I cut it. And then I actually add a curve this way so that when you go to tie it around his neck, you don't have all this excess bulk fabric. So that makes a better shape that fits better. And those of you who see my dog, you know he's pretty tiny. So this might look huge, but that's because I'm gonna hem it. I used to just cut them raw or use pinking shears, but the problem with that is, especially if they're rough plain, they can get caught on stuff and then just rip it. So I've started hemming them. So I just fold it over. I don't fold it over twice, I just fold it over once. But that's gonna bring the size down considerably. So whatever size you think you're gonna need, obviously you might have to play with it a little bit depending on the size of your dog, then cut that a little bit bigger to allow for hemming it. Again, you just need to fold it over once, especially if you're using a flannel like I got here. I like using the flannel ones for his scarves because they just hold up the best, and he likes them. It's the one thing, even though he's a skinny, tiny little dog, I can make sweaters. I have my own dog sweater pattern. Cody, he won't wear them. He hates the sweaters. I've tried them. He just acts like he's being punished. So even though he seems like he's always shivery and cold, he's happy with just his little flannel scarf. And then the other thing I have sitting here is a tie that I have to sew together, because when I make the patchwork skirts or just the skirts in general, I always make my tie in two parts. And then the back, I put a piece of elastic. So this is the inside. These pieces here are the parts that you actually tie that will hang outside the skirt. And this is the piece that's actually in the back of the skirt and is hidden. And I like to put a little piece of elastic that's about that long. And what that does is it makes a little bit more flex. If you want to tie the skirt real tight, you still at least have a little bit of flex when you go to move and bend. And so that's why I like having that elastic in there. And it also makes it fit a larger variety of people. So when I do my skirt, it's a one size fits most. Now I do custom skirts where I can make some longer or a little bit wider or even a little bit narrower if people need it, but mostly the size that I make does fit most people. A lot of you know I make and sell my skirts, but that's not how I started. I actually started by doing a video years ago. It was one of my very early videos showing how I took a 50-cent garage sale sheet and turned it into a skirt, and just a solid brown skirt. And so I will link to that video below. It's been one of my more popular videos all along because it's, you know, it's very simple to do. And then Stacy from Off Grid with Doug and Stacy, not too long after that video came out, had asked me if I would design and make her a patchwork skirt, which I did. And I had to think about it and designed it. She was very happy with it and ordered a few more skirts from me. And from that, because a lot of people see her in her patchwork skirts, orders for my patchwork skirts really started picking up. And then through the years, I've done some various different changes on how I put the skirts together. I have a few different styles I've come up with since creating that first patchwork skirt for Stacy. I've created some pockets. I have a video on just how to make and put the pockets into the skirt if you're interested. So I have a whole playlist just on the patchwork skirt because it's evolved as it's gone. So I have the original one that just shows me putting together a three-tier skirt. I have one that shows how to put in the pockets. I have another one that shows how I lay out the skirts now, because the way I lay them out now is different and better. It takes a little bit more time. I also have a video on how you can customize the patchwork style to fit children or larger women or whatever it is that you need. I'll link to the series down below. So don't just stop at the one. If you want to learn, like I just had a question today where somebody saw the original patchwork skirt video, they asked about pockets. Yep, I was able to link them to the pockets and how you can make and put those in very easy. So the skirt, I think that even if you're brand new to sewing, I believe that's something that you can do. Just watch the videos and see how I do that. Yes, I mean, I might be just taking it for granted because I've been sewing for so many years and I'm pretty much self-taught, and I've always created my own patterns. Same thing went for all the costumes that I made. For the years and years of dance shows that we put on, I came up with my own patterns, made the costumes myself. And same thing with this purse, I designed it myself. So to me, that might seem like it would be simple, but just give it a try and see. Even if you're new, I really do think that you could probably pull it off. And I just remembered another video that I have, another simple sewing project, and that is making yourself some little seed bags. So I like these seed bags for using for seeds that are bigger, like beans, nasturtium seeds, peas, corn. It's the same basic idea I use to make the tea bag, so I make cloth tea bags as well. It's just these are designed a little bit bigger. So if you're interested in making your own little bags, this could be multi-purpose. Use it for whatever you want. I made these to be seed bags, but you can make them a little longer and use them for pens and pencils or whatever you want. So anyway, I'll make sure I link to that video as well, and also to the tea bag video. So there's a few projects that you can do, and I know I'm probably forgetting some others, with some just scrap fabrics you have laying around if you do. But again, even if you have to buy some of these fabrics in the long run, such as with the napkins and the various things like that, you can really save yourself some money. So, and then the cloth tea bag, same thing. You can use the cloth tea bag for your own homegrown herbs, and then you don't have to, you just wash them out and reuse them. I always wash them by hand and then hang them to dry. Okay, hope you enjoyed this video and this gave you some ideas of some projects you can work on for yourself. All right, thanks for watching. Take care and God bless.